I would like to thanks first to our today's speakers, Bianca Streng and Regina Lamberts. And I would like to ask that they start with their webinars and presentation for today. Have a very nice and fruitful webinar.
Thank you very much. I would like to start with the presentation. I am Bianca Streng. I am a medical doctor in Utrecht, from Utrecht, Wilhelmina's Children Hospital, and I'm also a PhD candidate there. And currently I'm working at the PRIDE study, which is a study that investigates the immune response after SARS-CoV-2 vaccinations in Down syndrome. The topics that I want to address to are, for starters, the why SARS-CoV-2 is so different in people with Down syndrome compared to people without Down syndrome. Why is it so important and why is it an issue? Then I would like to go on with the immune system in people with Down syndrome, because this might be one of the reasons why SARS-CoV-2 is so different in people with Down syndrome. And I would like to close off with the first results of the PRIDE study, in which we again investigated the SARS-CoV-2 vaccines in people with Down syndrome. First, I would like to start with the SARS-CoV-2 in people with Down syndrome. Why is it so important? Well, we see that there is a higher risk of getting infected, and there is a more severe course of disease when they are infected. And why do they have a higher risk of infection? People with Down syndrome, a lot of people with Down syndrome, especially in their 20s and 30s, live in assisted living situations like group homes. And if they're older, around 50, 60 years old, they are more in nursing homes. And it's easier to get a SARS-CoV-2 infection there because there's more people together, living together, but there's also nurses or caretakers taking shifts. So there's people going in and out. And next to this, there might also be a limitation in understanding the information to protect them. For example, why they should be quarantined when people is having a runny nose, or why they should wear a face mask, or why there is another problem. And to conclude, to add to that, there's also the corona restrictions in several countries that may have influence on their usual activities. For example, going to work. People with Down syndrome are, it's good for them to have the same day-to-day scheme if that's possible for them. And if they have restrictions in this, this might induce mental stress and therefore challenging behavior, resulting in even less understanding of the restrictions for the SARS-CoV-2. Then the more severe course of disease, there is a pre-vaccination study done in the United Kingdom, which investigated two cohorts of Down syndrome compared to a control group. The first cohort of people with Down syndrome consisted of people, actually healthcare providers or parents, completing questionnaires in several countries around the world. And the second cohort of that study consisted of admitted patients to the hospital with SARS-CoV-2 in February till July 2020 in the United Kingdom. And this study, so that's pre-vaccination, showed us that there is a complication rate when people get with Down syndrome get a SARS-CoV-2 infection up to 60%. And the most common complications seen are the viral pneumoniae, acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is more of a high inflammatory syndrome, and a secondary bacterial pneumonia. Then this these complications could lead to hospital admissions, and in people with Down syndrome, this is up to 56%, which is quite a high percentage. Of these people who were admitted to the hospital, 50% should go to the intensive care unit. And if you compare that to the general population, so without Down syndrome, this percentage is much lower, around 16 to 17%. And of these people who were admitted to the intensive care unit, around 30% needed mechanical ventilation. So that's really invasive therapy. And if we then look at recent evidence, there was recently a study that identified clinical risk factors, so the risk factors for severe COVID-19 outcome leading to, for example, hospital admission or mortality, despite one or two vaccinations. And Down syndrome showed the highest increase in risk with a 12.7-fold increase in risk even after one or two vaccinations. So that's quite high. And then again, if we look at the mortality before vaccination, there was, the big study that I mentioned before. They have a really nice graph in their article, and on the y-axis there's age groups. So you see the age groups here. And then on the x-axis, you see the mortality rate after hospitalization. So people who were admitted to the hospital. In blue, you see the general population. And in red, you see the individuals with Down syndrome. So the combined cohorts. And if we look at the numbers, and it's also visual here, you see that there is a difference between the general population and people with Down syndrome. And if we look at the age-specific risk factors of age-specific risks, we see that above the 40 years of age, there's a big increase in mortality rate. And that's also seen in the statistical analysis, which showed that below the 40 years of age, there could be, after correction for comorbidities, there was no difference in mortality, but above the 40 years of age, there was still the difference despite correction for comorbidities. So one of the risk factors is an age above 40 years of age, and other additional risk factors were a male gender and obesity. So we know that there is a risk for people with Down syndrome when they get a SARS-CoV-2 infection. Then the immune system in Down syndrome. First, I would like to explain a little bit more about the immune system. So I will give a short introduction in the immune system. And afterwards, I would like to give you more insight in the alterations of the immune system in people with Down syndrome and why, if there could be an explanation in this for their problems with SARS-CoV-2. First, the immune system. The immune system is extensive and consists of a lot of components. So it's not possible for me to explain this in the short amount of time that I have. But to be short, it consists of an innate part of the immunity and an adaptive part of the immunity. And even though it's stated like these are separate parts of the immune system, these two parts work really well together. So it's not like so strict as I show you here, but it's more of an hybrid and dynamic part. And if we look at the innate immune system, that's the non-specific part of the immune system. So this is a barrier function, and it consists of anatomical barriers and non-specific cells and proteins. And it's mostly present in the skin and the digestive system, because these are the places that the most pathogens enter the body. This part of the immune system is fast. And it's not specific, so it reacts to every pathogen in the same way. And there is no memory. So there, if they encounter the same pathogen again, they will do exactly the same. And this is also stated here. So there are substances that are like standard, which is standard there. So it's no different compared to another pathogen. Then we also have the adaptive immune system, and this is a more specific part of the immune system. So this reacts to specific pathogens such as viruses and bacteria if they enter the body. So it's an acquired response, and it's also a little slower than the innate immune system. So the innate immune system is the first part, and then you have the adaptive immune system getting started. It consists mostly of cells and antibodies, and in these cells we have two sorts of cells. We have B cells and T cells, and the B cells are the cells that produce antibodies and also have memory for the antibodies, and the T cells are the cells that help the B cells killing the pathogen that enters the body. And to do so, we also need antibodies, which is very important in also in vaccine strategy. And because of the memory that B cells and T cells can make, this part of the immune system also has a memory function. So it remembers the pathogens you've seen before, for example, in your childhood, and will react faster if you encounter them again. And therefore, it's able to learn. So it will make a really nice and quick response if you encounter the same pathogen again. And the adaptive immune system is very important in the use of vaccines, for example, but also in the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic that we are in right now. Make it not too overwhelming for all of you, I would like to give you a little bit more insight in the immune system in Down syndrome and the alterations that we see there, but based on the adaptive immune system, so the specific part of the immune system, because evidence shows that the immune system of people with Down syndrome show premature aging, and this is compared to the general population. And there are signs of a continuously low-grade inflammation, even though there is no actual infection going on. So we see higher levels of inflammatory proteins without an infection being there. And this is also called inflammaging. So they combine the two words. And next to this, there's also something different in the cells with people with Down syndrome. So as I told you before, we have B cells and we have T cells. And in people with Down syndrome, we see lower amounts of circulating B and T cells in the blood. And if we look closely to the T cells, which is actually most known about in people with Down syndrome, we see that there should be a balance in new T cells and memory T cells. And new T cells are the naive T cells, and the memory T cells are, yeah, as it says, the memory. And what we see in people with Down syndrome is that they have less naive T cells, so they have fewer new T cells, and they have an accumulation of memory cells, which is also different compared to the general population of their age. And to conclude, there's also papers in evidence literature that show that antibody response after vaccination in people with Down syndrome is also lower compared to the general population. And it's for example, seen in after the influenza vaccination. So there's a few changes in altered immune system for people with Down syndrome, and there's a higher risk. So there's actually great need of a working vaccine for them. So COVID-19 vaccines have been registered for the use of children from the age of 5 years old and on, but none of them have actually been studied in people with Down syndrome specifically. And for better understanding, the vaccine types that I'm going to talk about are mRNA vaccines, Pfizer and Moderna, and the vector vaccines AstraZeneca and Janssen, because these are the vaccines that are used in the Netherlands. So, as I said before, there's a need of an effective vaccine for people with Down syndrome, and because of this, the PRIDE study was started in the Netherlands, and this is a prospective study. So we are monitoring the antibody response with in people with Down syndrome after the SARS-CoV-2 vaccinations compared to control. So we also have a healthy control cohort. It's what we call healthy control. These people are the control group, and they should be completely healthy because that's what the control group should give. And the vaccination in the study that we investigated was not part of the study, but part of the Dutch National Immunization Program. And the vaccines included in our study were a Pfizer vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, and the AstraZeneca vaccine. And how did we investigate it? Well, we did it with blood withdrawals. And the first blood withdrawal was at a time point one, which was at least 2 months before the first vaccination. We would like it to be as short as possible on the first vaccination. Then the first vaccination was given to the participants. And then 28 days after the first vaccination, we had time point two. Then they received their second vaccination, and 28 days after the second vaccination, there was time point three. And on all these time points, there was a blood withdrawal, and time point four, that's for the future. So I'm not going to talk about that. But time point three was the main outcome. So that's the part that we were most interested in. If we look at the participants included in our study, there was a total number of participants above the age of 18 years included in the study, and it was 370 participants. Of this group, there were 222 people with Down syndrome, of which we had 173 samples available for primary analysis. And of this group of 173 people, we had 128 people receiving Pfizer or Moderna vaccination and 45 receiving an AstraZeneca vaccination. We also had the healthy control group, as I told you before. And of this group, we had 97 available for primary analysis. And of this group, there was a group of 33 participants who received a Pfizer or Moderna vaccination, and 46 who received an AstraZeneca vaccination. And then the first results. This is quite a difficult graph, so I will explain to you. On the y-axis, we have a log scale. So this is not a regular scale, but it goes from 1 to 10 and so on. And it shows the specific spike antibodies to COVID-19. And on the x-axis, there is the time points. So time point one, time point two, and time point three for people with Down syndrome. And then in purple, you see the healthy control group. And these two last columns on the right side are people with Down syndrome who were COVID positive before vaccination. So that's what we saw in the antibody results, and the healthy controls who were COVID positive. And if we look at the results, we see that there's a vaccination effect. So we see that there's a higher antibody response on time point two compared to time point one, which is something that we expected. But there's also a higher antibody response compared to time point two if we look at time point three. So there is a vaccination effect. But if we look at the comparison between people with Down syndrome in blue and people without Down syndrome, so the control group, we see a significantly lower antibody concentration compared to control. So they have less antibodies. And as I told you before, we were very interested in age because this is a risk factor for people with Down syndrome. Again, on the y-axis, we have a log scale. And again, the spike antibodies But now on the x-axis, we have age groups. And what we see here, again, in the green-blue dots is people with Down syndrome. We see that they show visually, but also in the statistics, they show a lower antibody concentration with increasing age. So they, when they get older, they make less antibodies. And if we look at the control group, we don't see such effects. Then for people who received the AstraZeneca vaccination, this is actually the same graph as I showed you before, but still it's the log scale presenting the anti-spike antibodies. At time point one, there is no antibody concentration. Then at time point one, there's a higher antibody concentration, and time point three, there's a higher concentration compared to time point two. So there's a vaccination effect. And we also see in after AstraZeneca vaccination that people with Down syndrome show significantly lower antibody concentrations compared to control, the control group. Then in this group, we also wanted to test if age is a factor that influences the antibody responses. So again, on the y-axis, you see a log scale presenting the anti-spike antibodies, and again, the age groups. And in this group, we didn't see a correlation to age. So people with Down syndrome after AstraZeneca vaccination in our results don't show a lower antibody response with increasing age, but it has to be said that there's only a few people in the group above 40 years of age. So it's not sure if the results are really representative of the population. So to conclude our results, we see a decreased antibody concentration after Pfizer, Moderna, or AstraZeneca vaccination in people with Down syndrome compared to a control group without Down syndrome. And in addition, after an mRNA vaccination, for example, Pfizer or Moderna, we see a decrease in antibodies with increasing age. And then the developments after this study or while we're doing this study, the Dutch Health Council advised the government of the Netherlands to offer people with Down syndrome, the adult population with Down syndrome in the Netherlands, early booster vaccination. And this was also based on the results of our study, so the PRIDE study. And in addition to the primary study, we also are busy investigating the booster vaccination right now. And we are preparing a publication, and we hope that it's out there soon, because we think actually everybody around the world should benefit from this research, because it's so important to be protected against SARS-CoV-2. And we are also still investigating the pediatric part of the study. So that study is still ongoing, and we're still including new participants in that part. So we hope to be able to give results there too. So to conclude from this presentation, people with Down syndrome have more severe course of disease when they have a SARS-CoV-2 infection. They have an altered immune system, so this might influence the immune response, for example, after vaccination or when they get infected with SARS-CoV-2. And in our study, so in the PRIDE study, we found a decreased antibody response in people with Down syndrome after SARS-CoV-2 vaccination compared to a control group. So I would like to thank you all for your attention, and I would like to take this moment to thank our participants for participating in our study, because without them, we wouldn't be able to give this presentation and have these really nice results.
Thank you very much. I'm going now to the second presentation, and then we will have a questions and answer.
Afternoon. My name is Regina Lamberts. I am the director of the Dutch Down Syndrome Foundation. I'm a psychologist. And our foundation is very proud to work with Bianca and the team of the Pride Study of the University of Utrecht. It is an important research that means a lot to our people with Down syndrome. It's great that they have not only acquired new knowledge about how the vaccine works, but they also actively help making that knowledge applicable to all people with Down syndrome. I will tell you today about the purpose of my presentation, some stories about the first period, the long-term psychological effect for people with intellectual disabilities, risk factors for psychological problems, and I have some tips. I want to give some information about the corona pandemic in the Netherlands. It seems likely that corona will remain in our lives for a while. What can we learn from recent times? I will give some tips for the future. I present all qualitative knowledge. We have not done any quantitative research. During the first period, we started collecting ideas from parents and some mentors. In the first period, many positive consequences were mentioned. One-on-one attention at home shows growth. School tasks and tasks at home. A parent told us, I stick to the regular rhythm as much as possible. Get up on time and go to bed on time. Kim helps with the daily practical matters such as folding the laundry, loading the dishwasher, setting the table and cooking. She does that every day. As a result, she also takes faster steps. Kim enjoys it and we are both proud. We've got stories about teachers who think along well during the period the children were at home. There was ambulatory support at home. A mother told us, awesome. I am so grateful to the supervisors and teachers for taking that burden off my shoulders. Every method of nice extra they have found, video calls, if he is not motivated for a while, sweet photos, stories and calls, he enjoyed it. There was much more room for practice-oriented learning. A mother told us, cooking together is also learning. Planting plants, making cakes too. Parents mentioned they got to know their child better. A father, we also think it is a good experience to discover what he can and cannot do. We are amazed at how strong he is visually. How much effort it does take him to write. This experience teaches us more than a conversation with the teacher. And there was more time for other activities. A young woman with Down syndrome told us, due to the corona crisis, I was unable to work anywhere in the beginning. This made me a little angry and sad. When I made a lot of cards and drawings for sick and lonely people in the neighborhood. There were also negative consequences. There were less activities. A mother told us, the first week she went really well. She had a real holiday feeling. Schoolwork went well and she was having a good time. The third week, the turning point came. The realization that all the fun activities, swimming, fitness, meeting friends, were now really no longer possible. There were outbursts and angry words. Social distancing is difficult. A mother about a son who lives in an institution. We keep in touch via video and mobile and WhatsApp. Once a week, we do some shopping for him, which we then bring to him. We exchange the groceries at his terrace. This is emotional and weird because a hug is not possible. The rules are difficult to explain, a mother. And yes, then we have the social distancing. How do you explain that to a man who is so social, likes to cuddle with everyone? He kept asking about it. And other parents told us, Lotte has many questions about corona every day. We try to explain it as best as possible. The regular calls, she regularly calls her older sister, and she also has to explain it. She herself looks on the internet how things were going in other countries. Every day she asks if it will be ever okay. She's worried. People experience death of residents from corona, or they have been sick themselves. There were few periods when we have to stay at home. Our mother told us, after a week off, she was allowed to go to work for 2 more days, and then it was all over. She was sad and upset, so much that she passed out. That was because of the stress, she knows that. She thought it was her fault that she wasn't allowed to go. She misses everyone terribly. Then there are group dynamics. A mentor told us, there are residents who want to talk about corona all day long. And there are residents who don't want to hear about this. There is an argument about watching the news. There is a fight at the table. The relationship between parents and counselors or mentors can be stressful during the crisis. And some people can't understand other people's with their mask on, especially the one who've always read lips. This has an isolating effect. Today, we have been dealing with the virus for almost 2 years. Long-term effects are now also visible. Some children and grown-ups who have been indoors for a long time had difficulties with social interaction when they could meet others. A boy 10 years old. He has been home a lot last year due to COVID. Now he finds it very difficult to get out of the house again. He doesn't play at school because he doesn't know what to do. And for example, an amusement park or a parade, things he always liked, he's now scared, as if it dropped out of his system and now arouses great fears. There's another effect. Due to very little activity, people can become depressed. A mother about a young adult who is very depressed now. It no longer makes sense in his daily life. He cries a lot. In corona time, all activities have come to a halt. Instead of a whole day, he received 1.5 hours of activities per day. He had just to hang out for the rest of the day. He was looking forward to all kinds of celebration, his birthday and Christmas. And at the last minute, all was forbidden. That unpredictability. He seems to have given up hope that it will ever be fun again. A number of psychological effects of the pandemic is mentioned in the literature. Most literature is about the whole group of people with mental retardation, not only Down syndrome. Some people mention physical complaints like sweating, trembling, headaches, fatigue, loss or increase of appetite and pain. A lot of people are crying during the day or are sad during long periods. They experience tension or anxiety. They are more alert or nervous. They have constant a sense of concern or are worried. They experience insomnia or have nightmares. There is some irritation and anger about small things or as a state of being. We have seen an increase in verbal and physical aggression. And there are feelings of guilt and shame. They are the reason everyone is ill. People are confused, some withdraw themselves. They show psychomotor delay or arousal, so people are getting slower or restless. Some show disorientation and some show lots of skills. How do you reduce mental risk as a result of the pandemic? Stick to the day-night rhythm and take a short walk nearby. Take in account the 1.5 meter distance. Just an example. Keep in touch with teachers, employers and colleagues, therapists, caregivers and other relatives by phone, computer or iPad. Use social networking sites such as Facebook, Instagram to keep in touch with groups of people. You can also set up social support groups. Keep people active by doing work at home, pursuing hobbies and sports. Provide a space where people can withdraw from social group situations. There are also tips to make it easier to deal with the rules. Involve the person as much as possible in all phases. Find together understandable and accessible information about the virus. Involve important relatives in the explanation and in offering practical and social support. Practice along the hygiene rules. Repeat regularly and give positive feedback. Pay extra attention to the persons who have fewer opportunities for contact. Research with the person for suitable alternatives when support is no longer available. Make sure you have enough rest and time for reflection with other parents or colleagues. Share experiences and help each other. We made visual information about the rules. You can see here a general view. Every color has its own part. I'll show you the next one. The coronavirus, what does this mean for me? I hope the pictures will speak for themselves, but there I put a translation next to it. And another one, to prevent contamination, what to do? Anyone can download this from our website. We saw a lot of children and grown-ups with Down syndrome who suffer from tension and anxiety. How to deal with that? Realize that it's normal for people with intellectual disability to seek more closeness and be more demanding in times of stress and anxiety. Give lots of clear explanations, provide structure. Help them to find, help them ways to express distressing feelings such as tension, fear and sadness. Everyone deals with emotions in their own way. For some, it helps to be physically active. For others, creative activities such as drawing. It is important for people to feel enough space and to have time to express and share their feelings. Take into account the influence of behavior and emotions in the environment. Signal problems in time and respond to them. Finally, I will show you an interesting website. It's a Dutch site, but this website explains many things in an easy way. And Steffi talks also about corona. And especially for you all, Steffi explains everything in different languages. I will show you. So this is about the corona, and I can let hear you in English what it's about.
Welcome on this website. I will explain you everything about the coronavirus. I will tell you what to do and what not to do. This way you can make sure that you and others don't get sick.
Well, you can see all the subjects and everything is also at Turkish, Polish and other languages. It's very interesting to see. I hope I was able to give you some ideas in this corona time and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this, your presentation. It was very interesting, both our presentation. And now we are going to see what we have in question and answers part. Yes, we had one question from our Jacqueline London. She unfortunately left a meeting, but she asked to Dr. Bianca Strang, are the last results after vaccination being published?
Thank you for the question. Well, no, we're still working on publication, but that's an ongoing process. So we don't have the results yet, but we will, we do have the results, but they are not published yet. But we hope that it will be out there in the coming weeks. But this is a process that's really slow, so we're not able to speed it along.
Okay, thanks a lot for the answer. Our Jacqueline will hear later on your answer. We have some questions from some parents about situation that their children are, like example, 8 years old. They are, let's say, in quite a good health, and I worried quite a lot if is a vaccination a good idea or not. Normally, we don't expect that you will say cool answer. But what do we just think about this for the youngest children, as we have now Pfizer for the children from 5 to, I think, 12 years. And we know that is possible from this Pfizer vaccine now to take, I think, third part of the vaccine for the older person to give to the children. Do you know anything about this? How is situation in your country about this part? Just that we see and that parents think.
Yeah. Well, in the Netherlands, we didn't start with the vaccination yet. So the pediatricians have to send out a letter so the parents can decide whether they want to give their children a vaccination or let them give a vaccination. But still, that's a bit of part of a discussion in the Netherlands. But for now, the trend is to they want to vaccinate all vulnerable children and in the end also all children from the age of 5 years old. For us, we don't have any results yet because they didn't start yet. But we are still working on the part between 11 and 16 years old. So we do have a lot of inclusions there, but we don't have the results yet. So we're not able to say anything about antibody concentrations after the vaccination in the children yet. And to the question, should I let my child get a vaccine against COVID? Well, that's a really hard question for me to answer because I'm not a pediatrician. I am not someone who is actually in charge of saying anything about that. But what we do see is that the vaccines are given in, for example, the United States to a lot of children, and there is there are not a lot of big side effects seen there. So that's the only thing that I can say about it.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Dr. Strink. We had one very sad situation that one young girl from Slovenia after third vaccine from Pfizer. She has the first two from AstraZeneca, then third one, Pfizer. And unfortunately, after 12 days, she got thrombocytopenias and unfortunately leukemia. And she's nearly 1 month in the coma and on intensive care. That means after two AstraZeneca and then with Pfizer, this happened. It was 6 months between the second and third vaccine. But unfortunately, that happened. That's what we know from Ms. Tanya Ščuka from Yeah, Tash from Slovenia. Yeah, but we have another comments question from Maria Olsen. Thank you for a nice presentation. How relevant would you estimate that the decrease in the Down syndrome antibody response is to risks of COVID-19 development? T21 research team report that 0.8% of vaccinated people contracted a COVID-19 infection after vaccination. Thus, the protection seems to be quite good. I don't know, Bianca, did you see that this question and answer as well?
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah. Well, that's actually a hard question for me to answer as well, because we investigated at specific time points. So the time point three, as I showed you in my presentation, was at the time of 28 days after the second vaccination. And this is the point in which the antibody concentration are the highest. So they were measured at a peak level and they will decrease in time. That's what we know also in the general population, that that the immunity will decrease, because that's what time does. So it's really hard to say how somebody is protected against COVID on specific time points, because we only measured 28 days after the vaccination. And there are no specific thresholds known yet that correlate to protection. So we can measure the absolute number or the concentration of antibodies, but we are not able to say, well, if you have a level of, for example, 300 or 500, then you are protected. And to add to that, as I showed you in my presentation as well, the immune system is more than the antibodies alone. So the immune system consists of a really big system with a lot of counterparts that work together very well or not. And as I showed you in my presentation, people with Down syndrome have also problems or lower amounts of their immune system cells, so the B and T cells. And we are still investigating if the specific T cell response or the specific other responses of the T cells, if that is different compared to the general population, so our control group. So to say this antibody level correlates to protection, we're not able to say so, because we don't have the knowledge yet, and there is in the world there's no knowledge about a specific threshold yet, especially for specific groups like Down syndrome. And then the other part is that the immune system is more than the antibodies alone, so it's really hard to say if only one part of the immune system can give a correlation for protection, if it it consists of so many factors.
Thanks a lot.
So, unfortunately, I don't have the answer.
I guess for this next question also, we will not be able to answer to Svetlana Mikhailinkova. I hope that if I say wrong the family name, sorry, Svetlana. Question is about that if the person with Down syndrome has a COVID, maybe didn't have a so big, a reaction of the COVID. Is that okay or not for our children? Or there are necessary to vaccinate that person with Down syndrome later on after, because they were ill from the COVID-19. Before you just make any comments, like I saw that in your results that in participants you didn't involve this 41 person with COVID infection. Yeah, just vaccinated you included.
Yeah, we did have the results of them, and I showed them in the right columns. So what we saw, we investigated the people with Down syndrome as a whole, should I say, but then we also looked at the people with Down syndrome who didn't have COVID, and people with Down syndrome who did encounter COVID before vaccination or while they were given vaccinations, for example, between the first and the second vaccination. And we could measure that with the different antibody concentrations, so not the spike antibody concentrations, but the another part. So we took them aside and we compared the people with Down syndrome who got two vaccinations without any SARS-CoV-2 history, as I should say. And on the other hand, we have the people with Down syndrome who got two vaccinations, but they, along the way, came in contact with SARS-CoV-2 and also got a boost of that. And what that showed is that people with Down syndrome who didn't have the COVID infection, if I should say shortly, we say that people with Down syndrome who did have a higher antibody response. So if you have had a COVID-19 and then get two vaccinations, as a person with Down syndrome, you have higher antibody concentrations compared to people who didn't. And again, it's really important to still get a vaccination if you have had a COVID-19 infection, because as I said before, the immunity will decrease with time. So it's important to get another booster because they're so vulnerable. So yes, there's no reason not to get a vaccination if you have had a COVID infection before.
Yeah, just one comment more, Bianca. Just I think that I answer good to one our mother from Slovenia. She asked in the chart, general population, is that and the person with Down syndrome. General population are people who are, let's say, general population, people who doesn't have any syndrome, any problems, nothing.
Yeah. No, we have like in our research, we had the Down syndrome group, if I say shortly, and we had the healthy control group, and that's the general population. But we, to make a good comparison, we only asked people to participate in our study as a healthy control if they didn't have any comorbidity. So no cardiovascular diseases, no lung problems or different problems with the immune system, because that would interfere with our results. So we took people who are completely healthy as a control group.
Yes, thanks a lot. We have one question, French. I will try to translate, but let's see. Are there any, this is a Google translation, sorry. Are there any special side effect for people with syndrome Down, like example, 9 years old, compared to vaccinated? And for children ages 5 to 12 in the general population, the risk of the myocarditis seem to be greater. Is that case also?
Well, I have to be honest there. We still don't have the results from our study yet in this age group. So I'm not able to fully give an answer to that. And I'm also not a pediatrician again. So if this is a question regarding your own child and your own question, if you should give the vaccination to your child, I think it's really, it would be my advice to talk to your pediatrician about it, because they can give personal advice to you. And in our study, we also ask our participants to keep a diary for 7 days to see if there's any side effects, specifically in our Down syndrome group. But we don't have the results yet, so I'm not able to tell you anything about it. It's so preliminary. So if we have the results, we will be happy to share them with you again. But at this point, we don't have them yet.
Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot. I think that we have now a few questions. Yes, this time for Ms. Gina Lamberts. One of question, it is, how do you recognize depression in the person with Down syndrome? How is the situation with psychologists and psychiatrists in the other countries, if you know?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Mainly, it's of course difficult to detect depression with people with Down syndrome. Where you have to pay attention to is a change in behavior. So not wanting to do the things they always want to do, losing appetite, not going to school or work, and that changes if they are during a long time, weeks, then you can ask your pediatrician if we will watch and look and have an idea what's going on, because depression can be the case, but there can also be other things that has to be excluded first. In the Netherlands, you return to your pediatrician, and psychologists for children are not that usual, not that common. So mostly it's the pediatrician who helps you and find out. You have to know what is the normal pattern of behavior for the child or the adult, and what are the changes. And the changes will lead you to, shall we look at some physical things, or is it depression?
Thank you very much. I'll just continue with another question, a little bit similar from Helena Zupančić. Her question, it is, she has a son, 22 years, and is currently suffering from COVID. This year in May, I was vaccinated with second dose of AstraZeneca, and what she could see that he has a memory problems after vaccination. Is maybe that cause of the vaccine, or is because of this whole affects what you said and what you mentioned in your presentation?
Well, Bianca said it before, we don't have the numbers and the facts about side effects for after vaccination. So it's difficult to answer. And we know most problems are there for a short period and then they disappear. But just go to the people who know your child and that know about what's going on, because we can't answer this from this distance, and also not from the knowledge we do have at this point.
Yeah, I think in addition to Regina, I think it's important if somebody's experiencing side effects like this to talk to their care giver, like their GP or the pediatrician or somebody else who is their doctor. Because I think this is really hard for us to to see if this is normal or if this is something that could be a side effect, because it's
Yeah, I agree with you. This all our question are mostly because we are like parents worried so much for our children. And it so many times is difficult to see what is the results of the situation that our children and youngest are more time at home, not with the siblings, not with the other children, not in the school. And what is the reaction really of the vaccine? We all know, even for population without Down syndrome, without any problems, they have some post-COVID problems. And they are really different from person to person. It's very difficult to say what is exactly COVID, if you had a COVID, what is if you are vaccinated, and what is because of the time how we are living. And also, like you said, it's impossible to say something more, but it's one question from Christian. How much higher is the danger of serious COVID cause for Down children compared to the normal children? if you have no anything about that in the research.
No, we don't. But there is another a study done again in the United Kingdom from the same research group that gave the high numbers in the adult population, and they investigated this again, but then in children. But they have a little, like in children, the COVID infections are less severe. So that's something that we see like in the general population, including people of children with Down syndrome. But if we look at that results, and then I'm talking about somebody else's results, there is more complications seen in people with Down syndrome, so more complaints, so they have more coughing or fever, or compared to the general population of children. So it's really hard to say, because there's in general the mortality and complications are lower compared to adults, and that's also something that we've seen in the adult population, that the younger adults from 18 years old have lower risks compared to the older population of 48 years and older. So the risks are different, but it's not so clear how much higher the risks are. And it also depends on the comorbidities of the child. If a child is really healthy, it might be that COVID is less risky for them, but then it depends. It's not really predictable.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I think we answered on the most questions and comments. Okay, I see now that some others put also this your link from what Regina sent us, and I hope that everybody could go and look. Just one question to Regina: is it possible that translation for other language we send you, and then you put on your link as well?
Well, Steffi isn't ours. Steffi is an that website is of an other organization. So if you want to know, I can ask, but I think they choose the translations for different kind of people who live in the Netherlands. But whenever you have a question, look at the ETSA website and look at the Dutch Down Syndrome Foundation and mail, and I can try and pass it to the Steffi website, but Steffi website is not ours.
Thanks a lot. We will try to contact them and see possibility for other languages. I'm sorry, just we have one more question, I think, for Dr. Strang. I think that you have said that there is a disequilibrium between naive cell T and the memory cell T. What is the consequence?
Yeah, that's something that that's observed earlier in other research, that there is a disbalance between the naive T cells and the memory T cells. And that's something that we see when people get older, the general population gets older, they tend to accumulate memory cells. And these memory cells are important because they know a lot about the previous infections, but then you also need to have enough new cells, so the naive cells, that if you encounter a new pathogen, you can make a new reaction. So if you, it's with everything in the body, it's really important that things are in balance, and this is out of balance. So it results in more infections, more airway infections. That's also something that you might experience in your children or your brother, sister with Down syndrome, that they have more airway infections and more other infections. So that's something that we've observed, but we don't have hard numbers to say because of this disbalance, they have such percentage more risk on whatever. But it's something that it has been observed that there's a disbalance, and the disbalance is there earlier compared to people in the general population, because everybody has more memory cells when they get older. Like that's just normal in life. But what we see in people with Down syndrome, that they have it way earlier. So even in their childhood, they already have the alterations there in the T cell disbalance.
Thank you very much. Like you said, we parents and also experts who are working with our children learn a lot of things, what our children could have and what could not. It's really big difference from child to child, but in general, it's like you said, it's a lot of things what our children could have if we compare with, let's say, population without any difficulties. Okay, now Eric continue. And this discolabrium, it is easy visible for doctors on blood analysis. It's visible for doctors on the blood analysis, like example, or not?
I'm sorry, again,
In the question and answer it is, and this discolabrium, is it easy visible for doctors on blood analysis?
I think it's not easy. It's not a regular test done. So it requires an experienced lab to see this. It's not a regular blood test.
Yeah. Special for that. Thank you very much, Dr. Branka Singh and Regina Lamberts. It was a very big pleasure to have you on our webinar, our ETSA webinar for the December. To all of you who were today with us, we would like to say to you, have a nice time with your family, take care, and see next in the January on the next webinar. Have a nice afternoon. Bye-bye.